On this episode of the Great White North Report, Chinese researcher is escorted from an infectious disease lab amid RCMP investigation. China has banned Canadian pork products and is seeking to increase its examination after fraudulent certificates were found. After suspending Canada's meat imports, China demands Meng Wanzhou's release again. Meanwhile, she's having the time of her life, shopping after attending court in Vancouver. China scolds Canada for being naive in its approach to addressing the detention of its citizens and mustering so-called allies for its detainees. This is the Great White North Report. Hi, I'm Roman Desilvi, and this is the Great White North Report. Now, on July 5th, a researcher with ties to China was recently escorted out of the National Microbiology Lab in Winnipeg amid an RCMP investigation. Now, this is being described as a possible policy breach. Now, Dr. Zhang Guoqi and her husband, Kenning Cheng, I know I'm mispronouncing that name, and an unknown number of her students from China were removed from Canada's only level 4 lab. Now, for those who don't know, a level 4 lab is a virology equipped to work with the most serious and deadly human and animal diseases. And it's one of only a handful in North America capable of handling diseases requiring the highest level of containment, such as Ebola. Atlanta has probably the biggest one in North America. This comes after several months after IT specialists entered Kui's office after hours and replaced her computer. And I guess she'd been taking regular trips to China and they had started being denied. So it sounds more like she's a security risk than a policy breach, that like leaving a door open or not cleaning your clothes. You know, you see the movies all the time, they're in that hazmat suit, they go into a decontamination chamber and shower there, get everything cleaned off. When you're looking at someone else's computer and denying trips back home, then obviously that's something far different. On July 8th, the staff at the Winnipeg facility were told the researchers were on leave for an unknown period of time and they're told not to communicate with them. Again, that sounds really suspicious, and it sounds like the scientist and her husband, as well as her students, are sending reports back to China. And when they go back to China on visits, they're probably assisting a lab there, setting it up exactly like it is in Winnipeg and replicating what's been learned there. And that is concerning when you have things like Ebola virus. Kui is a prominent virologist. She helped develop a ZMAP. It's a treatment for the deadly Ebola virus, which has killed more than 11,000 people in West Africa between 2014 and 16, and flares up every so often. She's also worked with a professor in the Department of Microbiology and Infectious Diseases at the Research Center in Laval University. Professor Kui is a medical doctor from Tianjin, China. She came to Canada for graduate studies in 96, and she's affiliated with the university there. And she's brought in many students over the years to help her with her work. So when she's brought in many students, that means she's brought over many Chinese students. She's currently head of the vaccine department and antiviral therapies section in the special pathogens program at the lab. Her primary field is immunology. Her research focuses on vaccine development, post-exposure therapeutics, and rapid diagnostics of viruses like Ebola. So that makes sense that she would be looking up ways to get vaccines. After all, China was hit hard by the bird flu. They're getting really hammered over the West African swine fever. And China is a breeding ground for other diseases. Now, she's also a professor in the Department of Medical Biology, Microbiology at the University of Manitoba. Now, her husband, Shang, also works in the lab as a biologist. He has published in research papers on HIV infections, SARS, E. coli infections. On May 24th this year, the RCMP received a referral from the Public Health Agency of Canada. Based on the information received to date, the RCMP says there is no threat to public safety at this time. So it's being described as a policy breach and an administrative matter. And they're also striking that no one is under arrest or confined to their home. They're trying to assure Canadians there's absolutely no risk to the Canadian public and that the work for the NML continues to support the health and safety of all Canadians. So basically they're trying to calm fears that this Chinese scientist let something out that shouldn't have got out. That's quite possible. Mistakes can happen, but in this case, I don't think so. Some experts say this could be a case of intellectual property theft or technology leakage to China. I'm more in the favor of technology leakage to China in this field. She's probably sending reports back to China, helping them set up their own lab in China through email and by her own visits. Because there are some pretty sensitive biological research material that can be shared either with or without authorization with foreign countries. Basically, when you share something, you generally talk to your superiors asking if it's okay, as a courtesy. Now, this is something that the Canadian Security Intelligence Service has already been warned about. Now, we're facing threats from foreign governments seeking to steal intellectual property that could include state-funded research. And for myself, it'll be interesting whether or not these individuals are charged with crimes by the RCMP. That will give a lot of information of what really is at stake here. It might also play a part in the political game that's going on between Canada and China at the moment. You know, for those who remember, Canada-China relations have soured ever since Huawei executive Meng Wanzhou was arrested at the behest of the U.S. And she's waiting extradition. What China did was they went and arrested a whole bunch of Canadians, most of them on some dubious charges, and they're holding them. They're being held in actual prisons and probably being treated pretty badly, while Meng Wanzhou gets to go shopping. That's the difference between Chinese detention and Canadian detention. Right now, our relationship stems from China using espionage to advance its strategic interests, be that its security interests or its economic interests. Now, because this is a microbiology lab, it is possible to take that research for a vaccine, because before you do anything, you want a vaccine for it. You could weaponize Ebola. It is possible to weaponize it. And for anyone who says, no, you can't do that, it's too dangerous. Well, all it has to do is read this book. Tom Clancy, Executive Orders. This book was published in June of 1997. And in it, the Iranians to weaponize Ebola, and they release Ebola in the United States. Obviously, it does some damage and it causes some problems, but in the book, it's all taken care of. They find a way to combat it, or it's the strain burns itself out. Ebola burns itself out really quickly. But if you could genetically alter that to make it last longer so it doesn't burn itself out, then it could be very deadly. And of course, with something like that, Ebola, any virus that can go across borders, no matter how much you stop things, it'll get across. You want a vaccine handy. You know, and this isn't the first time police have investigated incidences at this particular lab. Back in 2009, a researcher was arrested for trying to smuggle genetic material from the Ebola virus across the Manitoba-North Dakota border. Conan Michael Yao had 22 vials of the substance in the trunk of his car when he tried to cross the border. Now, that guy was only sentenced to 19 days in jail, which he'd already served, and fined $500. I don't know, that's a lot. And the FBI is currently investigating a lot of Chinese researchers in the United States. We should be doing the same, checking emails. Now, because of this investigation into Dr. Kui, it's been suggested that other university faculty members avoid trips to China amid the RCMP probe. You know, that goes without saying. That's something the Canadian government and the RCMP should have been advising since last December with the arrest of Wanzhou. It's interesting to know the University of Manitoba ended the non-salaried appointments of both Kui, Professor Kui, and her husband Shang, pending the police investigation. It has reassigned an unknown number of graduate students working with Kim. It's just the Chinese students that are working with her. They're all working on the same stuff, and they're all under suspicion now. So now the university has circulated a memo to the faculty asking that avoid all unnecessary travel to China in light of our evolving relationship with China. Duh. Like, seriously, where have you been since December? A lot of Canadians have been getting harassed since December. The Communist Party will stoke the nationalistic fears and pride of China to such a point that it becomes almost a duty for them to question any Canadian-born person. Just ask Canadian businessman Michael Spavor and former Canadian diplomat Michael Korvig. They're accused of working together to steal state secrets. Okay, Spavor was working with North Korea, trying to open it up through goodwill gestures. So this is just another thing that's going on between Canada and China. We're finding more and more things that China does within Canada. They've become really intrusive into our society. And that's no surprise, since over the last 5 years, China makes up the largest immigration group in Canada. I guess as of this year, 1 in 5 Canadians are immigrants. The largest group of them are from mainland China. Now, on top of that, the Chinese have also detained another Canadian citizen for drug offenses. Now, my opinion is, if you go to a country like China and you're dealing with drugs, you deserve what you get. There are certain places where dealing with drugs is not a good idea. Anywhere it's not a good idea, but especially in places like China, the Philippines right now, North Korea. Now, China has also banned Canadian pork over some fraudulent certificates that were issued, and that's no surprise. Chinese will try and get around anything, any government regulations, in order to import something. And they'll use fake certificates from legitimate countries to do that, to import pork that might be susceptible to things like that swine fever that's been rampaging. So they put a ban on Canadian pork, even though our pork is probably better than what they're getting, what they themselves raise. But hey, if China wants to starve, so be it. Let them starve. at this point. With the way they are with the Communist Party of China, they deserve what they get when it comes to that. We need to show Beijing that threats will get it nowhere, whatever it costs us and whatever the fate of the Huawei executive Meng Wanzhou. Now, should we harmonize relations with them? No, I think we should back off. Prime Minister Trudeau and his government get tougher. Now, I would like to see toughen up. I've already done this on my first China report that I did. My very first one was based on it because I felt it wasn't being taken seriously enough, and we should. This all ties in together. It does, with the researcher and what happened last December. Now, going back to the Chinese-Canadian diplomatic dispute that's been going on, people need to know that China can afford to wait out Canada in any kind of diplomatic dispute. The Chinese Communist Party has all the time in the world because they will be in power indefinitely. Xi Jinping has already had the term requirements abolished, so he can now rule for life. Before, a Chinese premier can only last two four-year terms. But now he's abolished that, and they can wait. They will wait it out. And Canada has an election in 6 months. If they think they can cut a better deal, they will. And they'll never talk to the prime minister. They've already ignored any attempts he's made at calling them personally. The G20 summit, him and Xi Jinping didn't really talk that much. President Trump has talked to Xi Jinping. And all the other Western allies have also put pressure on China. China is increasingly isolated diplomatically when it comes to things like this. But they don't care. They can wait it out. If it takes 5 years, 10 years, 15, 20, they will wait it out. Time is on their side when it comes to this. Basically, if China doesn't get what it wants from the current Canadian government, it will wait for the next one before resolving its diplomatic issues. Chinese leaders don't have to worry about power changing every 4 years, and they can buy their time. So if we get the NDP get elected, oh Christ, that would be a huge, and the Chinese will take advantage of that. Trudeau government has not been tough enough on China. We have not clamped down on all the Chinese investments into our property. It's going to take years to get it back, to get relations back, and I, for one, do not really care. I know Canadian companies would love to have access to China, and they're living a pipe dream because it'll never happen. Not the way they think. China has regressed back to its 1960s approach to things. They're more afraid of their own people than they are of anyone else. I'm all for playing China's game, a mirror policy. If they do that to us, we do that to them. And let's see how they like it. In fact, I wouldn't be surprised if the Chinese government tries to interfere in our elections by providing money for candidates that support China. And it'll be interesting to see in this upcoming election if they do so. Anyway, that's all I got for this segment of the Great White North Report. Till next time, keep your stick on the ice. 10 billion people living in one room. Right, I'm singing. Hey, simple Jew. Right, I'm calling.